In terms of lessons learned, let's say that I may say that the project looked very carefully to the short-term and long-term challenge of forest landscape restoration. The project started in 2012 with a small project called the Mediterranean Mosaics, and through this project, DEFELAR activities did a lot of demonstration interventions in terms of building the ecological and socioeconomic resilience to climate change in the Chubut-Huesbeca landscape. This had a catalytic effect, important catalytic effect, because all these demonstration interventions were critical in order to attract the attention of actors at the national level, from the political level to the private sector, NGOs, etc. Even development agencies that are working in Lebanon visited the experience and realized that well, with not big amount of resources, we could manage to demonstrate how to implement a different set of activities, from active restoration in the field to the management of natural resources, to the use of waste, etc., etc., and how the interlink of these activities facilitated. Raise the interest of local actors because of the social and economic value of the activities, and facilitated to integrate ecological conservation with economic and social development. Thanks to this, we managed to bring a higher another level, which raising funds at the European Union level. And to respond to the national program on 40 million trees launched by the Minister of Agriculture. In that way, we enlarge the project interventions outside the landscape to other areas in Lebanon, and bring let's say bring mo raise more the attention of the experience in the Chubut-Huesbeca landscape to be replicable in other parts of Lebanon. As a result, we raised the attention of the major donor in the Mediterranean region in terms of biodiversity conservation, which is the MAVA Swiss, it's a Swiss foundation, MAVA Foundation, and the Chubut-Huesbeca landscape was selected among four landscapes in the Mediterranean region as a landscape to demonstrate how the recovery of cultural practices related to biodiversity should happen. This was a major contribution to the financial resources that supported forest landscape restoration in Lebanon, but also was a way to be recognized internationally and to facilitate the link between the experience in Lebanon with other experiences in other high-value landscapes in the Mediterranean region. And after that, we got the recognition from aid agencies like the Italian aid agency that wanted to support the recovery of ecological, social, and economic value of the rural landscape with a special focus on the work the FLR initiative was doing on agricultural terraces, also increasing. Contributing to increase the funding sustainability for FLR interventions in the landscape. In any case, the economic sustainability of the FLR initiative is a major goal, because the FLR vision in the landscape is a 20-30 years vision, and the project has done a number of interventions to look in terms of this economic sustainability from the evaluation of the ecosystem services in the landscape and understanding payment options for ecosystem services like water, carbon, which is something that is ongoing. Also, we realized that forest lands restoration is an expensive activity, and it is important that the same interventions can absorb the cost of forest landscape restoration. So supporting green value chains, which is a major aspect of the last finance that is supporting FLR in the Chubut-Spekka landscape, supporting green value chains will be a way to make FLR as an economically sustainable activity. The project is also developing and working a lot in partnerships with the corporate social environmental responsibility programs. Has launched a crowdfunding activity, Adopt a Cedar Tree, that has also contributed to a lot to the forest landscape restoration interventions. And is looking at the formulation of forest landscape restoration bankable projects under different frameworks like the forest and landscape restoration mechanism of FIO. And last but not least, very briefly, looking at some lessons learned from the FLR activity. FLR vision with integrated ecological, social, and economic objective is necessary to guide, harmonize site-level interventions in the different parts of the landscape and ensure its long-term sustainability. Forest landscape restoration, in our case, has always kept the ecological, social, and economic values as a principle in terms of the objectives, the landscape objectives, but also in terms of all the landscape or all the forest landscape restoration interventions. The analysis of the root causes of landscape degradation helps identify the strong links between direct threats and the drivers, and also to define forest landscape restoration priority interventions at the different levels, looking at the proximate, intermediate, and root causes. And the interconnection of these different levels will be critical to succeed in the interventions at the long term. In our case, but I think is the case of most landscape areas, solving tenure problems was fundamental to prevent conflicts. And this is why the project did a lot of efforts to define which land uses and to look at private, public tenure in the landscape, in the different, zoning of the landscape, and reach agreements between land users, landowners, before applying interventions, field interventions, because otherwise the conflict was there, and expensive interventions like FLR could become a failure if a conflict bring fire, cutting, or whatever that will destroy the interventions implemented. The governance structures that FLR established for the activities at the landscape level must demonstrate legitimacy, effectiveness, and efficiency. A clear vision and milestones should be shared by the different actors that are part of these governance structures. People in the field should realize what is the added value of the structures, the governance structures that are established. So we should avoid competition. If there is a governance structure that is managing the funds of the FLR intervention, actors in the field should not look at this governance structure as competing with funds with them, but as an actor that as a mechanism for them to get access to the available funding for FLR. The actors should feel that are well represented in the governance structures, and the consultation must be demonstrated. Everybody should be feel represented, and their views being considered in the governance structures. Diversity at all levels is a key element in the success of restoration of climate resilient forest landscapes. For us, looking at diversity at the landscape, so how to maintain the mosaic-like structure of the landscape and restore this mosaic-like structure that increase the resilience, how to increase the resilience, the species resilience of the habitats in the landscape, how to increase the diversity of in the use of native species and local crop varieties in the agricultural production systems. All this was fundamental because this increased the economic opportunities for the people, but also increased the capacity to respond to climate events, to the ecosystems, to the landscape itself, and to the the agricultural systems. The economic angle of the FLR interventions is pivotal. Again, in order to raise the interest and make landowners, land users, active members of the FLR initiative, and also in order to absorb the significant part of the FLR cost in the long term, any intervention that is being promoted as FLR in the landscape should have these ecological, social, and economic values under consideration. Identifying and engaging landscape champions to test and demonstrate best FLR practices through pilot interventions has a catalytic effect. We all know it's not just FLR, is in any forest, in any development and nature conservation project. Landscape champions are a key because they believe from the very start of the project in the objectives of the project. They are able to implement to innovate and to insist to test the activities, and thanks to these pilot interventions and the successful results, the catalytic effect will raise the attention and interest of other local landowners and users. So it's a major aspect of the project to identify these champions, to sit together with them, to facilitate their work, and to involve them in the project. Also, the continued capacity development support is a must. So the project, I mean, punctual capacity development activities are not efficient. The project should look at keeping the periodicity of the capacity development throughout all the steps of any intervention type in order and throughout the years, in order that after this repetition, land practitioners really understand how to apply innovative practices and keep doing this in the long term. Also, for the continued learning, not only the the support of multidisciplinary experts, but also peer-to-peer exchanges, in our case, has demonstrated to be a key successful factor. Supporting not only peer-to-peer from the landscape, but also peer-to-peer from other successful experiences in other areas, in this case, in the Mediterranean region, that share common problems and common values and features, has demonstrated to be a very successful approach. Pilot demonstrations also are key for unblocking policy barriers. So as much as is possible, the policy work should be backed with the successful stories from pilot demonstrations. And this became a very successful aspect to raise the interest and the understanding of actors at the national level in the ministries to make changes in legislations that didn't match well with what was needed in terms of natural resource management and forest restoration. And last but not least, adaptive management requires creative solutions to sustainably simplify monitoring systems. Monitoring is always a problem. In all the projects I've been involved, it's very costly. It's an additional work for not only for the project staff, but also for the people that are being involved in the project, the different stakeholders, the practitioners. So as much as we develop creative solutions to simplify monitoring systems and make sure that that every year monitoring is being kept and that the lessons are transferring to appropriate knowledge at the local, national, international levels, the best will be the best for the project and for others that are in the need of learning from these best practices in other landscapes in the region and internationally as a whole. And with this, I finalize my presentation. I thanks you for the attention. And in case you need more information, you have in my email address, also the email address of Nizar Hani, who is the director of the Shuf Biosphere Reserve. And also I included the web page where you can that you can visit and look for the different publications that will provide you more details about the forest landscape restoration experience in the Shuf West Pekaya landscape. Thank you very much. Bye.